iOS fan? What are you rocking right now? Is your iPhone game like Limbo? How low can you go? iPhone 7? Maybe you're a 10. Well, today we're talking iPhone 13, and it's important to put these reviews in context. So I'm gonna tell you all about these two of four new iPhone 13s. My review, the mini and the standard 13, and I'm going to tell you who I think they're for. Let's get into it. Hey, if any of these videos that you've watched on the channel here before have helped you, if this one helped you by the end, please consider hitting us with that thumbs up, hitting that subscribe button, and clicking on that notification bell so you'll be notified when we upload the latest content. And on Fridays, we do giveaways. We're giving away free stuff, y'all. So show up for Friday. All right? Let's do it. Care Bears.
Care Bears countdown. 4, 3, 2, 1.
Yes. I'm going to start this party with those lovable creatures whose superpowers are all centered around their hearts. And it is that strong heart which powers everything in the world, much like our own. A strong heart is central to good health, and Apple this year has done some noteworthy things with its heart. Specifically, it's the silicon I'm talking about. Cupertino's Care Bear Stare is powered by this year's A15 Bionic, a cuddly beast of a chip with a 6-core CPU, a new 4-core graphics processing unit, GPU, and a new 16-core neural engine. Pretty much everything I'm going to show you today is enabled by these advances in Cupertino computational science. And I've seen some folks around the web complain about the very thing I'm going to begin with. While certain elements of the iPhone 13 mini and its vanilla big sister have shrunk, this year's models are actually heavier and thicker than last year's. By millimeters, folks. Why? To enable more battery life. For years, I've lamented the thinness imperative, asking for thicker phones with larger batteries, and this year Apple finally took my specific advice because, you know, I'm that influential. The iPhone 12 mini and 12 were 134 and 164 grams respectively. The 13 mini is heavier by 6 grams at 141, while the 13 is now 10 grams heavier at 174 grams. And that translates to Apple's claim of 1.5 hours and 2.5 hours more battery life for each phone. Last year, I fell in love with the iPhone mini. It was unexpected. I like big phones and I cannot lie, but that cute little tidbit just tickled my fancy, except for the battery life. It wasn't terrible, but its diminutive size definitely left it a bit wanting in the stamina department. This year's 13 mini does better. 3 hours screen on time with an additional hour of lossless music streaming during my commute, over 18 hours of use before I placed the phone back on the charger. With the standard 13, my time was even better. Many nights, I couldn't even get my use past draining 70% of the battery. Other than battery size and weight, the iPhone 13 mini and 13 are identical. Same cameras, same processors, same OS, same 5G bands. But it's that heart, the A15 Bionic and its efficiency cores, coupled with iOS 15, which makes this battery life and many other features possible. Let's dive into those features. Let's begin with the front of the phones and the Super Retina XDR displays. The displays are brighter this year, clocking in at 800 nits with the ability to max out at 1200 nits for HDR photos and video. Both displays support Dolby Vision and it shows. Coming in at 5.4 and 6.1 inches, regardless of the size, you're going to be treated to what I won't hesitate to call some of the best displays for content consumption that I've looked at all year. So let's get to my video playlist. The Witcher, Episode 4. Unlike other displays, which I've said did a decent job of handling Yasiye in the shadows here. These actually do a great job of handling the noise in the black and shadowy areas of the image thanks to these custom Super Retina XDR displays. And those images, they're crisp and razor sharp. High quality displays like these have the ability to really show off the depth of field the cinematographers create when shooting, imbuing an almost 3D-like effect that you have to see in person. On the Our Planet episode, Coastal Seas, the colors are beautiful and consistent. Weaker displays tend to blow out the highlights of some of these underwater turtle scenes, and the colors are kind of all over the place, but not with the iPhone 13s. And again, that image clarity, that sharpness, it's outstanding. This eel shot has a bunch of debris in the water, and you can see the layers with the eel behind some of the debris and surrounded by others. And here, watching and listening to Thor Ragnarok, we get that image sharpness, but we also get some subtle hints of the stereo image layering as well when we hear Surtur drag his sword behind him. That, thanks to the stereo speaker setup found on both devices, with one speaker being at the bottom of the phone and the other at the top where the earpiece is. Overall, it's a very high quality experience. Even playing video games on the device is a delight, from the visuals to the sound design. The only thing which really sets these units apart from the pricier Pro models in this area is size, the Pro Max is larger, and refresh rate. Both Pro models get the 120 hertz refresh display treatment. Also on the front of the 13s is a reduced size notch, which includes Apple's True Depth camera, weighing in at 12 megapixels. But this year we get the new cinematic mode and photographic styles to add to the mix, along with video up to 60 frames per second at 4K resolution. iPhones tend to capture images which are very true to life with regard to color processing, but some folk may prefer images whose color leans toward highly saturated, and that's where photographic styles comes in. These aren't just filters. They actually use that neural AI processing to modify the tonal qualities of an image. You won't get a mode which augments the color saturation though. These styles consist of warm and cool looks which deal more with color temperature than saturation. The rich contrast mode gives you a more dramatic look by modifying the shadow and blacks. These same insights go for those rear cameras and the photographic styles modes, but we'll get to that more in a moment. Unlike last year, this front-facing camera's portrait mode actually does a consistent job of blurring the background, as you can see in these photos I took with the sun both in my face and behind me. I had mixed results with the entire iPhone 12 line at the time that I reviewed them, which may have been a software issue. And here's a cinematic mode sample. In this case, across both the video and audio, the phone's front 12 megapixel camera does a solid job reproducing this chocolate skin tone without blowing things out due to the sunlight. As far as the rest of the hardware goes, you know, both the front and the sides, you'll get a matte aluminum frame around that back glass and front ceramic shield covered display. IP68 certified. This year we get color options in pink, blue, midnight, starlight, and product red. Internally, the phones this year start with 128 gigabytes of storage, going up to 512 gigabytes. You also get enough 5G bands included that no matter which phone, which carrier you go to, you should be able to take advantage of whatever flavor of 5G they offer. And my speeds in testing were really good. The iPhone 13's ability to take advantage of T-Mobile's faster mid-band and millimeter waves networks is even now identified on device by the 5GUC logo, which doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get super fast blazing speeds everywhere you go, but it does let you know that when you are connected to those mid-band and millimeter wave towers. And you know what else is new that these phones take advantage of? The largest sensor they've put in their dual camera system to date. Apple says this new sensor lets in 47% more light, and it also now includes sensor shift optical image stabilization, which has trickled down to these non-Pro models from last year's 12 Pro Max. So let's take a look at what those larger sensors are capable of. I went to a metro stop and took some pre-dawn photos. If you've seen my reviews, you've seen these before. The layers, the sky shows little noise. The palm tree trunks have plenty of texture. Zooming in, you can even see where the palm leaves have been cut on this particular tree. The palm fronds themselves and the berries hanging from them all have details which are sharp, all things considered. As I've said before, lesser cameras and smaller sensors make a muddled mess of all these details. The ultra-wide doesn't fare quite as well, definitely more noise in the shot, but for a night shot and the ultra-wide lens, this is still a decent shot, particularly for the non-pro models. And let's take a look at what you're going to get from those sensors with photographic styles. This Pop Funko figure will provide us with a good model so you can see how the tone changes per photo. This is the standard look, no style applied. Here's vibrant and rich contrast and warm and cool. What do you think? Now let's talk cinematic mode. It uses AI to recognize when you want to shift focus from one subject in frame in a video to another. So, using my grandpa statue and the Funko Pop, you can see that as I move the camera, the AI assumes that move means focus is to be shifted from one item, one object, to the other. We'll see how well this acts over time, but this is the first iteration, and I have to say that it works pretty well for first-gen tech of this sort. I prefer to have manual control over this type of thing, but for the casual user, this is actually quite cool, and the artificial intelligence driving this is nothing to sneeze at. Having done my photo walk with these phones, they passed all the important tests with bright flowers. You can make out the details, the stamen, texture in the rose petals. This wall of ivy branches came out well with great texture and detail. The only place the phone struggled was with the highlights blown out on the right side of that image. The sign here is very sharp with pleasing color, and the rust on these chain links show solid amounts of texture, as does this long shot at high noon. I've already been asked by colleagues at work if they should buy these phones or not. I definitely recommend them, but that's based on what you have now. If you currently have an 11 or 12, it's not really a major upgrade for you, unless you're on the 11 and want the mini, because that wasn't available at the time. Any earlier model iPhone, a 7, a 10 perhaps, then head out to your Apple store and pick one up. If battery life is the most important thing to you, then I think you'll want to focus on the larger iPhone 13. You'll see longer life with it. And if you want to see more about what makes these phones pretty awesome with iOS 15, check my playlist here on reviews.org's YouTube channel, as the last video we put up for me was about some of what I think are the most important iOS features, though there are so many to look at. But you'll definitely want to check those out because it's going to show you kind of how things may be different from the previous phones you've had. So that's it. iPhone 13s, two of four, the mini and the vanilla, the 13, the standard 13. That's my review. What do you think? Are you looking at picking up a new iPhone, about upgrading? What do you think about the features? What do you think about the phones? What do you think about those pictures? Let us know in the comments below. If you have any questions I didn't answer as well, please go ahead and leave those in the comments below. I'll get to those. I'm Tashaka Armstrong for reviews.org. We don't take it lightly that you spent your time here watching with us. I will catch you on the next video.